morning and welcome back to EWTN's continuing live coverage here on day five Saturday of the 2019 World Youth Day, coming to you live and exclusively from Panama through EWTN. Father Mark Mary is down there on location with Jason Everett. Hopefully we'll get to connect with them in a little bit. This morning we'll bring you the Holy Mass with dedication of the altar of the Cathedral Basilica of Santa Maria La Antigua. And the invited guests will be priests, consecrated, and various lay movements. I'm Doug Keck, president of EWTN. I've been here all week long. We'll be here through Sunday with my cohort, Father Patrick Mary of our MFVAs. Those are our guys. He's our chaplain up at Washington, D.C., EWTN, of course. And it's great to see you. And you did a marvelous job, I have to say, for the March for Life. And, you know, some of your confreres are going to be working out on the Walk for Life West Coast today, later today, right?
That's right. Father John Paul and Brother John Therese, they're out there and getting ready to, actually, in between our break, right, this morning, this morning's coverage and the vigil, they'll be producing, shooting out from San Francisco.
Right, exactly. And obviously, we're doing the Mass. And then later today, we're going to have that vigil event. Now, there's another event in the middle of the day, I believe, that we won't be carrying.
That's right.
It's like a luncheon with some young people.
So the Holy Father's going to meet with the seminarians, I think, of the local archdiocese, and I think he's going to present them with a gift there.
Right. Is it a monstrance or something?
Yes. We've heard it's a monstrance that he'll be giving them. And, of course, that's a great a gift for them, and it's a reminder for all of us, too, the importance of Eucharistic adoration. And, again, that's a big part of the vigil tonight as well.
And we can see, obviously, just to mention to people that the Holy Father has arrived at the cathedral. He was outside. He's now inside, making his way up towards the altar, as we can see in the images. You see, obviously, you're talking about a cathedral that obviously doesn't hold a dramatic number of people. So, again, why priests, religious and consecrated, and also members of lay movements. And we're watching that image as the Holy Father makes his way up there. What's interesting about today, too, is that during the week, basically, the schedule was beginning on Wednesday through Friday, catechesis in the morning. In the afternoon, you had the Vocations Fair and the Garden of Forgiveness, and then you would have the Youth Festival. And then you'd have the Youth Festival running into the evening, and then as the Holy Father became involved on Thursday, and then, of course, the Way of the Cross. Now, today, there is nothing during the day in the sense of catechesis, so that's basically over, that part of World Youth Day. So really, what the youth are doing, that's why you won't see them necessarily here, is making their way out to where the vigil will be tonight.
That's right. And as you mentioned, it frees them up to get there, and that's where, again, that's a huge part of the spiritual aspect, the prayerful aspect of the whole World Youth Day. One thing, as you mentioned, Doug, I don't think we actually talked about it much earlier in the coverage, is just, as you mentioned, the catechesis and just the importance of that, that we get to know our faith, because how can we love when we don't know? And, you know, and catechesis is so important that we can often kind of push to the side, but it's good to know our faith, and not only to know it, but to be able to explain it to others, you know, who have questions about the faith.
It's interesting, too, because in many ways, over the last few years, and certainly I'd say maybe the last 10 years or more, the idea of catechesis has kind of come back. For a while, you know, being the age I am, I remember when, not to say that that was officially a bad word, but kind of, well, we're not into this kind of catechesis which lends itself to memorizing facts and figures. We're into more of experiencing life and people and all these things, which were not bad unto themselves, but obviously we tend to have this exaggerated idea where we throw the baby out with the bathwater, where instead of expanding our catechesis and putting some experiential things into the mix, we end up saying, well, let's get rid of the catechesis and the memorization and throw that out. And we end up with a lot of people without a lot of experiences, but have no context because they don't know what the church actually teaches about anything.
Exactly. And there's no content. So there's a complete loss of direction. We don't know where we're going.
Right.
And so there is certainly a great emphasis on catechesis, knowing the content of our faith, again, that we ultimately might grow in our love for the Lord. And, you know, with regard to this, too, just we just heard that today actually is being released at World Youth Day, a new app or an application mobile devices and phones. It's put out by the Dicastery for the Laity and Family and Life, and it's focused on bioethics. So, we just covered last week, right, the March for Life in D.C., and the big theme was pro-life is pro-science.
Right,
I think this fits right in with that the church is completely behind truth and science.
You know who could use this app? I think Father Mark and Jason Everett, who are out there in the field let's talk to them about what's going on before the Mass, and maybe they got their cell phones working, they can get that app going. Do we have Father Mark and Jason Everett?
Yes, hey Doug, thanks. Yes, we're out at St. John Paul II Field, Where the Pope will be this afternoon, this evening for the vigil. So it's a beautiful day again. It's just a long, huge expanse of a field here.
It must be 3 or 4 miles back and a couple hundred yards wide.
But yeah, today's a great day. We kind of missed what you were talking about in the open, but I know we were reading about the consecration of an altar.
Yeah.
You learned some interesting facts about that.
Yeah, I don't know how many Catholics are able to have this opportunity where they see a church consecrated and an altar consecrated and dedicated, but I got to see it at our home parish just recently, and the liturgy is one of the most beautiful rites you'll see that the church offers, just so rich in symbolism. You'll notice when the priests come in, they don't kiss the altar. It's the only liturgy where they don't do this because the altar hasn't been consecrated yet. It's not an image of Christ, and so it's not kissed on the way in, only for future masses. And in the altar will be four relics that are going to be there. The relics are placed in the altar after the Book of Revelation chapter 6, where St. John says that in the altar in heaven, he saw underneath it the souls of the martyrs that had borne witness to the faith. And so in the altar here at the church, they're going to have a relic of St. John Paul II, St. Oscar Romero, St. Rose of Lima, and St. Martin de Porres. And then the altar itself is going to be consecrated. The bishop and the pope is going to spread oil all over the altar, an oil of chrism, which is we're anointed with it, baptism, confirmation, and then ordination. And it's a sign that it's being set apart for holy use, and then it's going to be blessed with holy water as well. It's almost being treated as a person. Because it is the preeminent image of Christ in the church, the altar, because Christ is the altar, he's also the victim, and he's the priest.
It's fitting, it's beautiful, he's giving an address to priests, religious, lay movements today, because it is a powerful image for our own consecration. You know, they'll sprinkle the altar with holy water and have incense, and we're all consecrated by baptism and have a role to play in building up the body of Christ. So I'm expecting a beautiful address today. I'm sure he'll invigorate us all, to fulfill our mission, to fill our consecration. And I thought, too, it'd be interesting to talk about the significance of this church again. It's a basilica, a cathedral of Panama City. And I went through the history yesterday, but if you didn't see it, as we've said, this is the first Marian theme for an International World Youth Day. The Panamanian people, have received the faith, we could say, as the bishop says, Bishop Ulloa, from the hands of Mary. And the Spanish, in the 700s, the Muslims invaded Spain, the Iberian Peninsula, and then the Spanish were taken back in the 1200s, 1248, St. Fernando the King was taken back praying, and he was inspired by the Blessed Mother to go into the city to this mosque, and there he had this wall became transparent, and he saw this image that was painted there of Our Lady, and it's of the purification, and he had instantly just had this tremendous devotion to her, and in this image in particular. So they brought that image with them in different forms in their explorations. They used it to inspire themselves and through her prayers to take back their country from the Moors. And so that was in the 1200s. And when the explorers and the Spanish came here and established the first diocese of the Americas, Panama City, 1513, they brought that devotion. They named the cathedral after her, St. Mary the Ancients, because that was part of the ancient basilica that was in Seville that had been turned into a mosque. And so that's the current title of the basilica today that you're going to see, and you're going to see the Pope praying before a statue of Our Lady of Antigua today, and he's going to present a rose for her, because traditionally that's the image. She's holding a rose without thorns, holding the Christ child with a turban. That's the presentation of Jesus in the temple. This is the painting, and so she comes to the temple. So it's just a beautiful devotion. I think that should inspire us all, especially those of us who live in the Americas.
And the church itself has beautifully been restored. There is a team of 20 Portuguese art restoration specialists that have been assigned to renovate the entire church, bring it back to its original beauty. And I guess in the process of renovating the church, one of their greatest finds, they discovered a 20-meter by 10-meter painting. So basically 60 feet high, 20, 30 feet wide, a painting that had been apparently buried for years behind some coats of other paint in the wall, and they were able to fully restore that. that. And so they're doing what should be done in the church, not a renovation, you know, we're taking all the sacred out, but a true renovation where they're bringing out the sacred. And so they've done in preparation for the Holy Day.
Right. And so, yeah, we have about a minute left. I guess we're moving quite along, but you see, hopefully you can see an image of the cathedral now, and it is it's just stunning. It's really stunning, even down to the organ. It's a beautiful cold organ. But Doug, we'll throw it back to you in the studio as we prepare for the Holy Father visits to the cathedral.
Excellent. A lot of great information there, Father Patrick, from Jason Everett there, talking about what we're going to be seeing and what goes on and the understanding of why the relics are inside, Catholic churches inside an altar, that scriptural basis, obviously, mm-hmm. which so many people think, well, where's that in scripture?
But that's right.
Turns out it actually isn't. And of course, Father Mark. And one of the things we saw while we were listening to Jason and Father Mark was you saw the Holy Father come in and put a rose to the statue of Our Lady, right?
Yes, and we see that, we've heard that as well, like what he'll do in Rome, I think, whenever he comes back from a trip or before he goes out, he'll place the flowers before an image of Our Lady, again, showing his devotion to Our Lady and entrusting everything to her. And of course, that fits in great with the theme of this World Youth
Day. And I wasn't sure, maybe I almost thought that it was the kind of idea that the rose is usually there, and then they take it out so that he can put it back in. But that might, maybe I read that someplace, but maybe I'm incorrect. But I think there might have been something along those lines. As part of her statue, but that might be incorrect. But let me ask you, you also had some additional, while Jason was talking, he was saying, yeah, that's right, and there's a couple other things.
Yes, you know, Jason did a great job and Father Mark talking about how the altar symbolizes Christ, and they mentioned some of the things that are going to take place when this altar is consecrated, dedicated, with the chrism and the incense and all that. But also if we look at the roots, like, you know, in the Old Testament and even in pagan times, an altar was always associated with the worship of God, right? And a sacrifice, it's intimately connected with sacrifice. We know that, again, that in the New Testament, again, our Lord himself offered himself in sacrifice, laid down his life, you know, for our salvation. And then what happens is oftentimes a lot of maybe non-Catholics will think that, okay, you Catholics, you believe that Christ is being sacrificed again and again, in every Mass.
Right.
But, you know, we learn from Scripture in the New Testament, too, that no, Christ died once and for all. It's that one sacrifice of Christ 2,000 years ago that's made present on every altar. So the altar is still intimately connected with sacrifice that's made present on every altar. And also the connection with, you know, they mentioned the relics that are going to be inserted in there. And that goes back in from the time of the early church. Mm-hmm. Masses were offered on the tombs of the martyrs.
Absolutely.
And it showed that, again, it was because of Christ's sacrifice that gave them the strength to lay down their lives, you know, for the gospel and for the faith.
Right.
And that carried on, and now we see that when relics are being placed in the altars.
Well, one shameless plug before we go out to Vatican commentary. Maybe that person should watch Father Spitzer's Universe and explain all to you about God in relation to time and how the ability for that to occur, even from a scientific perspective, of understanding God is outside of time, a moment in time, he can touch, it is there, you are there at that moment, it all collapses into one. And that's the way to think about it. And speaking of that, we've got some commentary from our friends at Vatican Radio, so they've got the information. Let's hand you off to them.
Virtue of the faculties granted by John Paul II accepted the request of the Archbishop of Panama and confirmed Santa Maria la Antigua as the patroness before God of the Republic of Panama. And not too long ago, 2014, following a request from the Panamanian Bishops' Conference, the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments conferred on the cathedral the title of Minor Basilica. Today we will be witnessing the consecration of the altar, and as with all sacraments and other rites in the church, we will be able to understand a bit both through the proclamation of the Word of God that we will be hearing, as well as by the gestures and the things that are used throughout the rite. Prior to coming here this morning, our Holy Father met with two groups of young people. He met with a delegation of 40 young Polish pilgrims on a cruise throughout the world. On the occasion of the World Youth Day in Panama, the name of the group is A Gift for Young People. They're also celebrating the centenary of the reconquest of independence, won, as we know, in 1918, even though momentarily. Our Holy Father thanked them for the beautiful initiative that they had began and were doing. The group arrived in Panama on the 22nd of January. And then before arriving here at the cathedral, before Mass, the Holy Father greeted a group of young people from France, accompanied by the vicar of the Archdiocese of Paris. So our Holy Father making sure that he greets various groups of young people while he's here. And now we prepare ourselves to participate in this Mass. It is a Mass proper to the dedication of an altar. And the hymn that we are hearing comes from one of the Psalms.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. La gracia y la paz estén con todos ustedes en la Santa Iglesia de Dios.
And now we move into the blessing of the water. Beloved brothers and sisters, we have gathered here with joy to get to dedicate a new altar by celebrating the Lord's sacrifice. Let us join in these sacred rites with fervent hearts, listening to God's word with faith and sharing joyfully at the Lord's table. Let us raise our hearts toward the blessed hope. As we come together at one altar, we draw near to Christ, the living stone, in whom we grow into a holy temple. But first, let us humbly call upon God that in his kindness he may be pleased to bless this water he has created, with which we are to be sprinkled. As a sign of repentance and a remembrance of baptism, and by which the new altar will be purified. O God, through whom every creature comes forth into the light of life, you accompany all people with such great love that not only do you nourish them with fatherly care, but you mercifully cleanse them of their sins with the dew of charity and constantly lead them back to Christ the Head. For in your merciful plan, you established that those who descend as sinners into the sacred waters to die with Christ should rise free from guilt and be made his members, heirs with him to an eternal reward. Sanctify, therefore, with your blessing, this water you have created that sprinkled on us and on this new altar, it may be a sign of the cleansing waters of salvation in which we have been washed in Christ and made a temple of your Spirit. Grant that with all our brothers and sisters who will celebrate the divine mysteries at this altar, we may come at last to the heavenly Jerusalem. The Holy Father will now bless the new altar with the water that has just been blessed. In this case, the altar which we see now, which will be dedicated, receiving a blessing of the Holy Father. Before we continue with the liturgy,
Dios Padre de Misericordia, a quien dedicamos este nuevo altar.
May God, the Father of Mercies, to whom we dedicate this new altar on earth, grant us remission of sins and allow us to offer the sacrifice of praise for all eternity at his altar on high.
Oh.
Oremos. Oh Dios, que quisiste que tu hijo fuera levantado en el altar de la cruz.
Who willed to draw all things to your Son, lifted high on the altar of the cross, fill your church, we pray, with heavenly grace. As she dedicates to you this altar, the table at which you will plentifully nourish the faithful you gather as one, and will shape day by day through the outpouring of the Spirit a people consecrated to yourself. We now move into the Liturgy of the Word. We will hear three readings today taken from the votive mass for the dedication of the altar, the first from the book of Maccabees.
Lectura del primer libro de los Macabeos. El día 25 del mes noveno, es decir,
on the 25th of the ninth month, Chislev, in the year 148,
con sus hermanos y toda la asamblea de
the priests
Israel
rose at dawn and offered a lawful sacrifice on the new altar of holocausts which they had made.
Un sacrificio conforme a la ley. El altar fue inaugurado con cánticos.
The altar was dedicated to the sound of zithers, harps, and cymbals at the same time of year and on the same day on which the pagans had originally profaned it. The whole people fell prostrate in adoration, praising to the skies him who had made them so successful. For 8 days they celebrated the dedication of the altar, joyfully offering holocausts, communion sacrifices, and thanksgivings. They ornamented the front of the temple with crowns and bosses of gold, repaired the gates and the storerooms, and fitted them with doors. There was no end to the rejoicing among the people, and the reproach of the pagans was lifted from them. Judas, with his brothers and the whole assembly of Israel, made it a law that the days of the dedication of the altar should be celebrated yearly at the proper season for 8 days, beginning on the 25th of the month Chislev, with rejoicing and gladness.
Lleguemos hasta el Señor dándole gracias. Lleguemos.
Let us come before the Lord giving thanks. Ring out your joy to the Lord. Hail the rock who saves us. Let us come before him giving thanks with songs. Let us hail the Lord. A mighty God is the Lord, a great King above all gods. In His hand are the depths of the earth, the heights of the mountains are His. To Him belongs the sea, for He made it, and the dry land shaped by His hands. Let us bow and bend low. Let us kneel before the God who made us. For He is our God, and we, the people who belong to His pasture, the flock that is led by His hand. Our second reading this morning from the letter to the Hebrews.
Lectura de la carta a los Hebreos. Jesucristo es el mismo ayer, hoy y siempre.
Jesus Christ is the same today, yesterday, and forever. Do not let yourselves be led astray by all sorts of strange doctrines. It is better to rely on grace for inner strength than on dietary laws which have done no good to those who kept them. We have our own altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. The bodies of the animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for the atonement of sin are burnt outside the camp.
Son quemados fuera del campamento. De la misma manera, para santificar al pueblo con su sangre.
So too, Jesus suffered outside the gate to sanctify the people with His own blood. Let us go to Him then outside the camp and share His degradation. For there is no eternal city for us in this life, but we look for one in the life to come. Through Him, let us offer God an unending sacrifice of praise, a verbal sacrifice that is offered every time we acknowledge His name. With which the Book of the Gospels will be venerated. And the deacon now receives the blessing from the Holy Father as the choir chanted the Gospel acclamation. The Father seeks true worshipers to worship Him in spirit and in truth, says the Lord. Ourselves to listen to the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
El Señor esté con ustedes.
Y con su espíritu.
Lectura del Santo Evangelio según San Juan. En aquel tiempo llegó Jesús a un pueblo de Samaria llamado Sica.
At that time,
cerca del campo en que Jacob a su
hijo, the Samaritan woman said to Jesus,
allí estaba el pozo de
I see you are a prophet, sir.
Jesús, que venía cansado del
Our fathers worshipped.
Se sentó sin más en el brocal del pozo. Era cerca del mediodía. Entonces llegó una mujer samaritana a sacar agua. La mujer le dijo a Jesús, Señor, ya veo que eres un profeta.
The Samaritan woman said to Jesus, I see you are a prophet, sir. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, while you say that Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. Jesus said, believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. For salvation comes from the Jews. But the hour will come. In fact, it is already here. When true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. That is the kind of worshiper the Father wants. God is spirit, and those who worship must worship in spirit and truth.
Palabra del Señor.
Gloria a mi Señor
Jesús. And our Holy Father now being helped down the steps in order to arrive at the podium, and we prepare ourselves to hear his homily.
En primer lugar, quiero felicitar al señor arzobispo, que por primera vez después de casi 7 años puede encontrarse con su esposa, con esta iglesia.
For the first time,
viuda provisoria
after 7 years.
Y felicitar a la viuda que deja de ser viuda hoy con el encuentro con su esposo.
And he's saying that his, he's no longer a widow because after this, because of the idea that the bishop is married to the local church, he will have his bride back. He wants to thank everyone for all who've made everything possible, and also the people of God, everything that you've done.
Con su pueblo, no en casa prestada, sino en la suya. Muchas gracias.
So that the Archbishop will now be able to welcome him properly into his own home.
El programa estaba previsto que esta ceremonia,
program that was foreseen,
por falta de tiempo,
ceremony,
tuviera dos significados, la consagración del altar,
should have two
y el encuentro
meanings,
con
the consecration of the altar, the dedication of the altar, and a meeting with priests, religious, and the consecrated laity. So what I will say will follow, and I will speak to priests and religious and consecrated lay, especially to those who work in this particular church in Panama.
Era la hora del mediodía.
Jacob's well was there, and so Jesus, wearied as he was with his journey, sat down beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." The gospel we have heard does not shrink from showing us Jesus wearied from his journey. At midday, when the sun makes all its strength and power felt, we encounter him beside the well. He needed to relieve and quench his thirst, to refresh his steps, to recover his strength in order to continue his mission. The disciples personally experienced the extent of the Lord's commitment and readiness to bring the good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners, to comfort those who mourned, and to proclaim a year of favor to all. These are all situations that consume life and energy, yet they show us many important moments in the life of the Master, moments in which our humanity too can find a word of life. Weary from the journey. It is relatively easy for us, compulsively busy as we are, to imagine and enter into communion with the Lord's activity. Yet, we do not always know how to contemplate and accompany his weariness. It seems this is not something proper to God. The Lord knew what it was to be tired. And in his weariness, so many struggles of our nations and peoples, our communities, and all who are weary and heavily burdened can find a place. There are many reasons for weariness on our journey as priests, consecrated men and women, and members of lay movements. From long hours of work which leave little time to eat, rest, and be with family. Toxic working conditions and relationships that lead to exhaustion and disappointment. From simple daily commitments to the burdensome routine of those who do not find the relaxation, appreciation, or support needed to move from one day to the next. From the usual and predictable little problems to lengthy and stressful periods of pressure, a whole array of burdens to bear. It would be impossible to try to cope with all these situations that assail the lives of consecrated persons, but in all of them, we feel the urgent need to find a well to quench our thirst and relieve the weariness from the journey. All these situations demand, like a silent plea, a well from which we can set out once more. For some time now, a subtle weariness seems to have found a place in our communities, a weariness that has nothing to do with the Lord's weariness. It is a temptation that we might call the weariness of hope. This weariness is felt when, as in the gospel, the sun beats down mercilessly and with such intensity that it becomes impossible to keep walking or even to look ahead. Everything becomes confused. I am not referring to that particular heaviness of heart felt by those who feel shattered at the end of the day, yet manage a serene and grateful smile. I am speaking of that other weariness, which comes from looking ahead once reality hits and calls into question the energy, resources, and viability of our mission in this changing and challenging world. This weariness paralyzes. It comes from looking ahead and not knowing how to react to the intense and confusing changes that we as a society are experiencing. These changes seem to call into question not only our ways of speaking and engaging, our attitudes and habits in dealing with reality, but in many cases they call into doubt the very viability of religious life in today's world. And the very speed of these changes can paralyze our options and opinions, while what was meaningful and important in the past can now no longer seem valid. Brothers and sisters, the weariness of hope comes from seeing a church wounded by sin, which so often failed to hear all those cries that echoed the cry of the Master, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" We can get used to living with a weariness of hope before an uncertain and unknown future, and this can pave the way for a gray pragmatism to lodge in the heart of our communities. Everything apparently goes on as usual, but in reality, faith is crumbling and failing. Disappointed by a reality that we do not understand or that we think has no room for our message, we can open the door to one of the worst heresies possible in our time. The notion that the Lord and our communities have nothing to say or contribute to the new world now being born. What once arose to be the salt and light for the world ends up stale and worn.
Dame de beber.
Give me a drink.
Las fatigas del camino acontecen y se hacen sentir.
Weariness from the journey can happen. It can make itself felt. Like it or not, we do well to have the same courage as the Master and say, "Give me a drink," as was the case with the Samaritan woman, and perhaps with each one of us. We want to quench our thirst not with any water, but with the spring of water welling up to eternal life. Like the Samaritan woman who for years had been carrying the empty pitchers of failed loves, we know that not just any word can help us regain energy and prophecy in our mission, not just any novelty, however alluring it may seem, can quench our thirst. We know, as she did, that neither knowledge of religion nor upholding options and traditions, past or present, always makes us fruitful and passionate worshipers in spirit and in truth. Give me a drink is what the Lord begs. He asks us to say those same words. To say them, let us open the door and let our wearied hope return without fear to the deep well of our first love, when Jesus passed our way, gazed at us with mercy, and asked us to follow him. To say those words, let us revive the memory of that moment, when his eyes met ours, the moment when he made us realize that he loved us, not only personally, but also as a community.
Poder decir, dame de beber, es volver sobre nuestros pasos.
It means saying, give me a drink means retracing our steps and in creative fidelity, listening to how the Lord, how the Spirit inspired no specific works, pastoral plans, or structures, but instead, through any number of saints next door, including the founders of your institutes and the bishops and priests who laid the bases for your communities. He gave life and fresh breath to a particular moment of history when all hope and dignity seemed to be stifled and crushed. Give me a drink means finding the courage to be purified and to recapture the most authentic part of our founding charisms, which are not only for religious life, but for the life of the Church as a whole, and to see how they can find expression today. This means not only looking back on the past with gratitude, but seeking the roots of their inspiration and letting them resound forcefully once again in our midst. Give me a drink means recognizing that we need the Spirit to make us men and women mindful of a passage, the salvific passage of God, and trusting that, as He did yesterday, He will still do tomorrow. Going to the roots helps us, without a doubt, to live in the present without fear. We need to live without fear, responding to life with the passion of being engaged with history, immersed in things, with the passion of lovers.
La esperanza cansada será sanada y gozará de esa particular.
A wearied hope will be healed and will enjoy that particular tiredness of heart when it is unafraid to return to the place of its first love and to find in the peripheries and challenges before us today the same song, the same gaze that inspired the song and the gaze of those who have gone before us. In this way, we will avoid the danger of starting with ourselves. We will abandon a wearisome self-pity in order to meet Christ's gaze as He continues today to seek us, to call us, and to invite us to mission.
El encuentro del primer amor.
Just as He did when we first met Him, when He first met us, our first love.
No me parece un acontecimiento menor.
For me, it is no small thing that this cathedral now reopens its doors after a lengthy renovation. It has experienced the passage of the years as a faithful witness of the history of this people. And now, with the help and work of many, it wants once more to show us its beauty. More than a formal restoration which always attempts to reproduce the original appearance, this restoration has sought to preserve the beauty of the past while making room for all the newness of the present. A Spanish, Indian, and Afro-American cathedral thus becomes a Panamanian cathedral, belonging both to past generations and to those of today who made it possible. It no longer belongs only to the past. It no longer belongs only to the past, but it is a thing of beauty for the present. Today, it is once more a place of peace that encourages us to renew and nurture our hope, to discover how yesterday's beauty becomes a basis for creating the beauty of tomorrow. This is how the Lord works.
Sí, la peculiar fatiga del corazón, del que lleva adelante todos los días lo que le fue encomendado en la mirada del primer amor. Hermanos, no nos dejemos robar la esperanza.
Brothers and sisters, may we not allow ourselves to be robbed of the beauty we have inherited from our ancestors. Let it be a living and fruitful root that will help us continue to make beautiful and prophetic the history of salvation in these lands. Present reacting to our Holy Father's homily, in which he cited numerous times from an interview he gave to Fernando Prado, which has been published in a book called The Strength of Vocation. We will now pray the creed, and the rest of the rite of the dedication of the altar will then follow.
Creo en un solo Dios, Padre Todopoderoso, Creador del cielo y de la tierra, y de todo lo visible y lo invisible. Creo en un solo Señor Jesucristo, Hijo único de Dios, nacido del Padre antes de todos los siglos. Dios de Dios, luz de luz, Dios verdadero y bueno. De la misma naturaleza del Padre, por quien todo fue hecho, y que por nosotros los hombres y por nuestra salvación bajó del cielo, y por obra del Espíritu Santo se encarnó de María la Virgen. Por nuestra causa fue crucificado en tiempo de Poncio Pilato, fue sepultado. Y resucitó al tercer día según las Escrituras,
y subió al cielo, y está sentado a la derecha del Padre.
Y su familia no tendrá fin. Creo en el Espíritu Santo, Señor y Dador de vida, que presenta. Nuestras plegarias, queridos hermanos, suban a Dios Padre Todopoderoso por Jesucristo, el único mediador, al cual se hayan asociados todos los santos como partícipes de su pasión.
Beloved brothers and sisters, let our prayers ascend to God, the Almighty Father, through Jesus Christ, to whom all the saints are joined as sharers in his suffering and companions at his table. Those present have been invited to kneel. And now there will be the Litany of Saints.
San Andrés. Santa María Magdalena.
Lord, be merciful. Lord, deliver us, we pray, from all evil. From everlasting death. By your incarnation. By your death and resurrection. By the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Nosotros que somos pecadores.
Be merciful to us sinners. Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer. Govern and protect, keep the Pope and all the ordained in faithful service.
Para que asistas al Papa.
Govern and protect your holy church.
Para que concedas paz y concordia.
Bring all peoples together in peace and true harmony.
Para que nos fortalezcas
Strengthen us and keep us in your holy service. Consecrate this altar for your worship.
Jesus,
Son of the living God, Christ, hear us. Christ, graciously hear us.
Te pedimos, Señor.
Mercifully accept our petitions, we pray, O Lord, through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, so that this altar may be a place where the great mysteries of salvation are accomplished, and where your people offer you gifts, make known their desires, pour out their prayers, and bring forth every sentiment of worship and devotion. The people now rise. Now coming forward toward the altar as the ministers gather. The relic now being placed into the altar. Our Holy Father venerating the relic before placing it into the small niche. Looks like there may be more than one. Has been a custom since the very beginning of the church that altars be erected over the tombs of the saints, and this custom still carried out by placing relics of martyrs within the altar at the time of its dedication.
Te alabamos, Señor, te bendecimos, porque en tu inefable designio de amor.
And now we have the prayer of dedication. We glorify you, Lord, and we bless you, for in the ineffable sacrament of your love, you have decreed that the mystery of the altar should be brought to fulfillment in Christ, to whom all types and shadows give way. For Noah, a second father of the human race, once the flood had receded, set up an altar to you and offered a sacrifice which you, Father, accepted as a pleasing fragrance, thereby renewing our covenant of love with the human race. Abraham, our father in faith, clinging to your word with all his heart, constructed an altar so that by not sparing Isaac, his beloved son, he might be pleasing to you. Moses, too, the mediator of the old law, built an altar which, sprinkled with the blood of a lamb, would mystically prefigure the altar of the cross. All this Christ has fulfilled in the Paschal mystery, for by ascending the tree of the cross as priest and victim, he handed himself over to you, Father, as a pure oblation, so that the sins of the whole world might be blotted out and a new and eternal covenant be made with you. Therefore, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, pour forth from heaven your sanctifying power upon this altar, built in the house of the church, that it may be an altar dedicated for all time by the sacrifice of Christ, and stand as the Lord's table, where your people are refreshed by the divine banquet. Let this stone, cut and shaped, be for us a sign of Christ, from whose pierced side flowed blood and water, by which were established the sacraments of the church. Let this be a festive table to which the guests of Christ hasten with joy, so that, casting on you their cares and burdens, they may gain new strength of spirit for new paths ahead. Let it be the place of intimate communion with you and a place of peace, where those who feed on the body and blood of your Son may be filled with his Spirit and grow in love. Let it be the source of the church's unity and of fraternal harmony, where your faithful gathering as one may drink of the spirit of mutual charity. Let it be the center of our praise and thanksgiving until we come jubilant to the eternal dwellings, where we are to offer you the sacrifice of unending praise with Christ the High Priest and living altar, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, by his power, sanctify this altar, which by our ministry we anoint, so that as a visible sign it may express the mystery of Christ, who offered himself to the Father for the life of the world. And at this time, the altar will be anointed with chrism. The anointing makes the altar a symbol of Christ. As we just heard in the prayer, Christ is the living altar, who before all others is and is called the Anointed One. That's what Christ means in the original Greek. For the Father anointed him with the Holy Spirit and constituted him high priest, so that on the altar of his body he might offer the sacrifice of his life for the salvation of all. Father is now rubbing the chrism oil into the altar, Using oil to dedicate things to God has its roots in it, the Old Testament. Altars are set aside for sacrifice. And early in Christianity, the altar became representative of Christ himself, the perfect sacrifice. And so, since Christ's name means the Anointed One, it's most fitting that the altar, which is a symbol of the Anointed One par excellence, is itself anointed with oil.
Recito mis versos a un rey. Mi lengua.
The oil that's used is chrism. The local bishop consecrates this oil during the Triduum. And before it's blessed, this particular oil is mixed with balsam, which is a sweet aromatic perfume used since ancient times, possibly with a connection to Corinthians, where St. Paul refers to the fragrance of Christ that Christians have to leave wherever they go.
Las traen entre alegría y algafara. Van entrando en el palacio real. Eres el más bello de los hombres. En tus labios se derrama la gracia. Señor, te bendice eternamente. Me brota del corazón un poema bello. Recito mis versos.
Our Holy Father, who had divested of the chasuble before anointing the altar with oil, now is revested with the chasuble.
Traen entre alegría y algazara. Van entrando en el palacio
real. Let our prayer rise, O Lord, like incense in your sight. And as this house is filled with a pleasing fragrance, so let your church be fragrant with the aroma of Christ. Now the incensing of the altar will take place. Incense burned on the altar to signify that Christ's sacrifice there perpetuated in mystery ascends to God as an odor of sweetness, and also to signify that the people's prayers rise up, pleasing and acceptable, reaching the throne of God.
Yeah.
Father himself now being incensed by the minister, and in turn the assembly. A fitting gesture that reminds us that as the Lord truly offers his sacrifice here on the altar, he also wants to be able to offer that sacrifice on the altar of our own hearts as baptized members of his body. Will now be covered, and candles will now be placed. Possibility of viewing this new altar. Fathers of the Church, we, through faith, have the certitude that Christ was the victim, priest, and altar of his own sacrifice, as we find in the letter to the Hebrews that Christ is presented as the high priest, who is also the living altar and the heavenly temple. And in the book of Revelation, our Redeemer appears as the Lamb who has been sacrificed and whose offering is taken by the holy angel to the altar in heaven. And since Christ is the head and teacher, is the true altar, his members and disciples are also spiritual altars on which the sacrifice of a holy life is offered to God. And we know in the sacrament of baptism, we too receive a new garment, symbolizing our new relationship in Christ, just as this altar is now receiving garments. We adorn the altar with cloths fitting to it. And it does seem that the fathers of the Church also had this in mind. Saint Ignatius of Antioch asked the Romans quite plainly, "Grant me only this favor, let my blood be spilled in sacrifice to God while there is still an altar ready." And Saint Polycarp exhorted widows to lead a life of holiness, "For they are God's altar," he said. Saint Gregory the Great said something very similar when he said, "What is God's altar if not the souls of those who lead good lives?" Rightly then, the heart of the just is said to be the altar of God. And in another image that's often used by writers in the Church, Christians who give themselves to prayer, who offer intercession for their brothers and sisters, and present sacrifices of supplication are the living stones out of which the Lord Jesus builds the church's altar.
La luz de Cristo ilumine la mesa del altar.
May the light of Christ shine upon the table of this altar, and may those who share the Lord's Supper shine with his light. The candles will now be lit by the deacon. The lighting of the altar teaches us that Christ is a light to enlighten the nations. His brightness shines out in the church and through it to the entire human family. We see different ministers have different functions in this rite, a reminder that all of us, priests and people, gather around the one altar on which the Eucharistic sacrifice is offered, but each with a different function. We celebrate the memorial of Christ's death and resurrection, and we partake in the banquet that he prepares for us. And so the altar has been prepared as the table of a spiritual banquet, as adorned for a feast. Thus the dressing and the candles on the altar signify that this is the Lord's table at which he invites all of us to dine. He wants to refresh us with divine food, namely his body and blood sacrificed for us on the altar of the cross. Offertory procession. It is the Archbishop of Panama who receives the gifts, for as we heard, since his cathedral has been under construction, he had no place in which to receive these gifts. Now he does so again with the reopening and rededication of this altar. For it is only now that the sacrifice of the Mass can be offered on this altar, now that it has been dedicated, set apart, to have only one use. It's not something that we can just set things down on. No, this has one use. This is the table of the Lord. It is something sacred. And so we continue with the liturgy of the Eucharist now. This table, as at every other altar throughout the world, representing Christ the Lord, acting in his name, truly accomplishes what the Lord himself did and what he handed on to his apostles to do in his memory. The earliest account we have of this is through the Apostle Paul when he says, "The blessing cup that we bless is a communion with the blood of Christ, and the bread that we break is a communion with the body of Christ." The fact that there is only one loaf means that though there are many of us, we form a single body because we have a share in that one loaf.
Que este sacrificio mío y de ustedes sea agradable a Dios Padre Todopoderoso. Te rogamos, Señor Dios nuestro, que descienda tu Espíritu Santo.
May your Holy Spirit come down upon this altar, we pray, O Lord our God, to sanctify the gifts of your people and graciously to cleanse the hearts of all who receive them.
El Señor esté con ustedes. Levantemos el corazón. Demos gracias al Señor nuestro Dios. En verdad es justo y necesario.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Having become both the true priest and the true oblation, he has taught us to celebrate forever the memorial of the sacrifice that he himself offered to you on the altar of the cross. Therefore, Lord, your people have raised this altar, which we dedicate to you with joyful praise. Truly, this is an exalted place where the sacrifice of Christ is ever offered in mystery, where perfect praise is rendered to you and redemption flows forth for us. Here is prepared the table of the Lord, where your children, fed by the body of Christ, are gathered into the one holy church. Here, the faithful drink of your Spirit from the streams that flow from Christ, the spiritual rock, through whom they too become a holy oblation, a living altar. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks. As in exaltation, we acclaim.
Oh,
The Eucharistic prayer is number 3.
Que por Jesucristo, tu Hijo, Señor nuestro, y con la fuerza del Espíritu Santo, das vida y santificas todo, y congregas a tu pueblo sin cesar, para que ofrezca en tu honor un sacrificio sin mancha, desde donde sale el sol hasta el ocaso. Por eso, Padre, te suplicamos que santifiques por el mismo Espíritu estos dones que hemos separado para ti, de manera que se conviertan en el cuerpo y la sangre de Jesucristo, Hijo tuyo y Señor nuestro, que nos mandó celebrar este misterio. Porque él mismo, la noche en que iba a ser entregado, tomó pan y dando gracias te bendijo, lo partió y lo dio a sus discípulos diciendo: tomen y coman todos de él, porque esto es mi cuerpo, que será entregado por ustedes. Del mismo modo, acabada la cena, tomó el cáliz. Dando gracias, te bendijo y lo pasó a sus discípulos diciendo: tomen y beban todos de él, porque este es el cáliz de mi sangre, sangre de la alianza nueva y eterna, que será derramada por ustedes y por muchos para el perdón de los pecados. Hagan esto en conmemoración mía. Este es el sacramento de nuestra fe. Así pues, Padre, al celebrar ahora el memorial de la pasión salvadora de tu Hijo, de su admirable resurrección y ascensión al cielo, mientras esperamos su venida gloriosa, te ofrecemos en esta acción de gracias el sacrificio vivo y santo. Dirige tu mirada sobre la ofrenda de tu iglesia y reconoce en ella la víctima por cuya inmolación quisiste devolvernos tu amistad, para que fortalecidos con el cuerpo y la sangre de tu Hijo y llenos de su Espíritu Santo, formemos en Cristo un solo cuerpo y un solo Espíritu.
Que Él nos transforme en ofrenda permanente, para que gocemos de tu heredad junto con tus elegidos, con María la Virgen, Madre de Dios, su esposo San José, los apóstoles y los mártires, y todos los santos por cuya intercesión confiamos obtener siempre tu ayuda.
Te pedimos, Padre, que esta víctima de reconciliación traiga la paz y la salvación al mundo entero. Confirma en la fe y en la caridad a tu iglesia peregrina en la tierra, a tu servidor, el Papa Francisco, a mi hermano José Domingo, obispo de esta iglesia, a mí, indigno siervo tuyo, al orden episcopal, a los presbíteros y diáconos, y a todo el pueblo redimido por ti. Atiende los deseos y súplicas de esta familia que has congregado en tu presencia. Reúne en torno a ti, Padre misericordioso, a todos tus hijos dispersos por el mundo, a nuestros hermanos difuntos y a cuantos murieron en tu amistad, recíbelos en tu reino, donde esperamos gozar todos juntos de la plenitud eterna de tu gloria. Por Cristo, Señor nuestro, por quien concedes al mundo todos los bienes.
Por Cristo, con Él y en Él, a ti Dios Padre omnipotente, en la unidad del Espíritu Santo, todo honor y toda gloria por los siglos de los siglos.
Amén, 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 amén.
And we are now invited to pray the Lord's Prayer.
Sido derramado en nuestros corazones con el Espíritu Santo que se nos ha dado. Digamos con fe y esperanza. Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo,
santificado sea tu nombre, venga a nosotros tu reino, hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en la tentación y líbranos del mal.
Líbranos de todos los males, Señor. Concédenos la paz en nuestros días, para que, ayudados por tu misericordia, vivamos siempre libres de pecado y protegidos de toda perturbación, mientras esperamos la gloriosa venida de nuestro Salvador Jesucristo. Señor Jesucristo, dirigiste a tus apóstoles, la paz les dejo, mi paz les doy. No tengas en cuenta nuestros pecados, sino la fe de tu iglesia. Y conforme a tu palabra, concédele la paz y la unidad. Tú que vives y reinas por los siglos de los siglos.
Amén.
La paz del Señor esté siempre con ustedes.
Y con su espíritu.
Como hijos de Dios, intercambien ahora un signo de comunión fraterna.
And we've been invited as the children of God to exchange now a sign of fraternal communion. So we might exchange that sign with those with whom right now we find ourselves. Here we see the many more who have gathered outside of the cathedral in order to participate in this Mass with the Holy Father. Holy Father also exchanging the sign of peace with a representative of an ecumenical representative. Exchanging a sign of peace with the President of the Republic of Panama. And now returns to the altar.
es el Cordero de Dios, que quita el pecado del mundo. Dichosos los invitados a la cena del Señor.
Present now receiving the body and blood of Jesus Christ, which has now been consecrated on this altar for the first time. Of the dedication of an altar is a very rare rite which takes place. So we've been blessed to be able to participate in this rich celebration today, being reminded also of our own participation in the mystery we have been witness to today. For it is also a reminder that the children of the church, those of us who have been baptized into Christ, have the power to celebrate the memorial of Christ and to take our place at the Lord's table. This is something new with Christianity. Prior to that, only priests offered the sacrifice, and no one else was present. But because of our participation in the mystery of Christ and his presence within us, we too participate in the sacrifice that he renews. Many altars, as we said, have relics or the body of a saint. But the dignity of the altar does not rest on the honor that the martyr's body gives to it, but on the fact that it is the table of the Lord. The altar does honor to the martyr's tomb, not the other way around. The church teaches it is altogether proper to construct altars over the burial place of martyrs and other saints, or to deposit their relics within or beneath an altar as a mark of respect and as a symbol of the truth that the sacrifice of the members has its source in the sacrifice of Christ. Thus, those who have been triumphant come to their rest in the place where Christ is victim. He who suffered for us is placed on the altar, on top of the altar, where those who have been redeemed by his sufferings are beneath, always beneath. Once again, see here imitated what we read in the book of Revelation. I saw underneath the altar the souls of all the people who have been killed on account of the word of God. Those who are assembled here, continuing to receive our Lord in Holy Communion,
oremos. Concédenos, Señor, reunirnos siempre en torno a tus altares.
Keep us, O Lord, ever close to your altar, where the sacrament of sacrifice is celebrated, so that united in faith and charity, we who by Christ are nourished into Christ may be transformed, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Santo Padre, hoy abrimos una nueva página en la historia del pueblo de Dios en Panamá.
Holy Father, today we turn a new page in the history of the people of God in Panama, in this Cathedral Basilica, dedicated to Santa Maria la Antigua.
Humilde y sencilla, en la casa rancho del cacique Sémaco. La Iglesia Católica en Panamá ha entretejido su historia.
The history of the Catholic Church in Panama is woven into that of the history of the people. And this church has witnessed this journey in which there have been many joys and sorrows, but above all, hope as well. As successors of the apostles in communion with the Vicar of Christ, we are convinced and committed to accompanying you in this process of conversion, which the Church needs in order to recuperate the image of the authentic Church of Jesus Christ, a merciful Church, one that draws near, is welcoming, is servant, is poor on behalf of the poor, so as to be a house of welcome and communion for everyone, without excluding anyone. We trust in the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ when he said, "And I say to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." In this cathedral, Basilica of Santa Maria la Antigua, the Catholic Church is present, an expression of a people who received the faith 505 years ago from the hands of the Virgin Mary. This is the faith that we all want to renew before the successor of Peter, Vicar of Christ, in order to say, like Mary, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word." Holy Father, you are not alone in this process of renewal and conversion. You can count on our fidelity and on our prayers. We are a church that walks with hope, hand in hand with Mary, under the title of Santa Maria la Antigua. In the name of this Panamanian church, we want to offer you an image of the servant of God.
Y San Juan Pablo II iniciaron estas jornadas mundiales de la juventud.
Who, along with Pope John Paul II, initiated the World Youth Day. So he's presenting him with an image. I didn't catch the name, but it seems with another person who, with John Paul II, initiated World Youth Day. The words we just heard were from the Archbishop of Panama, Jose Domingo Ulloa.
Señor, esté con ustedes.
Inclinen la cabeza para recibir la bendición.
Que Dios, que nos ha enriquecido con el sacerdocio real, les conceda que cumpliendo santamente sus deberes puedan participar dignamente en el sacrificio de Cristo.
Amén. Que Él, que nos congrega en torno a una sola mesa y nos alimenta con un solo pan, les conceda tener un solo corazón y una sola alma.
Amén.
Para que con el ejemplo del amor fraterno atraigan a Cristo a aquellos a quienes ustedes les anuncian el Evangelio.
Amén.
La bendición de Dios Todopoderoso, Padre, el Hijo y del Espíritu Santo, descienda sobre ustedes y permanezca para siempre.
La alegría del Señor sea nuestra fuerza. Pueden ir en paz.
Thank you.
those who concelebrated and were the ministers for this celebration, now taking their leave of the altar. The name Santa Maria la Antigua also has roots to Rome, because there is a church with that name in the Roman Forum. This ends now the live broadcast of the liturgy celebrated by Pope Francis in the Cathedral Basilica of Santa Maria la Antigua with priests, religious, and members of lay movements. Pope Francis will now go to St. Joseph Major Seminary, where he will eat lunch with the seminarians. And later this evening, he will take part in the World Youth Day Vigil in Metro Park, which has been renamed St. John Paul II Field. For complete coverage of World Youth Day, be sure to visit the Vatican News web portal, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You can find us on YouTube as well. On behalf of Vatican Media, thank you all for joining us. We'll be back again later today with more live coverage of the 34th World Youth Day taking place in Panama. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.
There you have it. We thank our friends at Vatican Radio. I think Sister Bernadette, perhaps, was the one providing the commentary again today, as she did last night, I believe. I'm Doug Keck here on set with Father Patrick, viewing the events throughout the day. Obviously, this was the Mass and the reconsecration of the altar there. Have you ever participated in anything like that, Father?
I have not participated in one, but I've seen plenty. I remember when seeing video of actually our shrine in Hanceville, when that altar was consecrated. Of course, also in, I remember, it may have happened at more than one, but I remember in Sydney, Australia, Pope Benedict had also, there was a consecration of an altar there.
So is that a typical thing that they do during World Youth Day to have that, or just timing issues?
It might, really? You know, that'd be interesting to find that out. I know it did take place in Australia and Sydney, but it's always, again, it's very rich in symbolism, and again, it's a preparation for just the importance, as we talked about before, of the altar, and that's made for sacrifice, that one sacrifice of Christ on the altar. And so you see there's a lot in there, and there's, again, the rich meaning between all of the actions that took place there with the chrism, with the candles, with the incense, you know, symbolizing our prayers rising up before God. It's pretty rich in symbolism.
Right, exactly. And, of course, later today we'll be bringing you the vigil. So look forward to that. That's always another big event at our World Youth Days. Before we get out to Father Mark, I was wondering if you had any reflections on the homily the Holy Father made. I thought it was interesting in a sense, the way, and it makes sense that it was kind of focused, since it was priests, religious, and lay movements, and really talking about the idea of dealing with the weariness of your work, especially when it seems like it's not making any difference.
That's right, and that's a great topic, because it's so easy for us to get so bogged down in our work, and it's good work, right? The work that we do. But we need to be careful that we don't burn out. But he mentioned, he had a great intro talking about how, you know, the Lord knows about weariness, right? And we saw that from the gospel account that we heard, that the Lord himself was wearied. He experienced it, and that helps us. And it reminds me of, you know, what Mother Angelica said, that, you know, she said before the incarnation, we could legitimately ask God, Lord, do you know what it's like to suffer, you know, to be tired, to be weary? But, you know, when he became man, yes, he did experience all this. He experienced weariness. He experienced suffering. Right. So that he knows what we're going through. And that's a great connection to start off with.
Right. And I think many times wonderful priests, religious, and lay people, especially a lot of times lay people get involved with lay movements. They get inspired. They're, you know, enthused. And you have to be careful. And the one example I always thought in my mind was our Lord didn't heal people 24/7. You know, he went away in the boat to rest. You know, we need to get away. I need to pray. You know, there needs to be this downtime.
Yes.
And I guess what our Holy Father is talking about, the water from Jacob's well, we need to be refreshed. We need that spirituality. We need to reconnect with the roots of our charism, of our founders, or what it was that led me to want to follow the Lord.
Yes, and he talked about the first love, right, getting back to that, and it made me think of, in the book of Revelation, you know, when our Lord is addressing the local churches, in the church of Ephesus, he said, you know, I know all your good works, you know, which are good. But he said, but I have this against you. You've lost your first love. Mm-hmm. And that's so helpful. I remember in seminary, my spiritual director saying that, you know, when we're going through difficulties, it's always good to go back to that moment that either we had a conversion or we encountered Christ, or again, to think of our first love. That can strengthen mm-hmm. us, right? It gives us, okay, Lord, I know you're present. I know you called me right. to this, and you're going to give me the grace.
Right.
And so one of the ways, too, that, you know, the Holy Father mentioned, yeah, is going back to our own individual conversion or moments, you know, powerful moments when we encounter the Lord, but also, as you mentioned, to the founder. So for us, it's, you know, Mother Angelica, both right. for the network and our community, or whatever particular community one is with, to get back to what the founder's charism was, because the Holy Spirit was working powerfully.
Right, exactly, and that's the part. And also, yeah, because you can get caught up in some things, you have to step back and say, why is this such a big deal to me? You know, I remember Mother having her own different experiences, whether it was a near-death experience or something, but one of the things that kind of came out of it was kind of this, don't sweat the small stuff would be a colloquial way to say it, mm-hmm. that we get caught up in some of these things and we really have to trust the Lord. And like you said, look back and say, let's look at the big picture. That's we right. can get caught up in everyday little things that don't work right, or get caught up in what's minutiae, mm-hmm. and we need to pull back and get the big picture.
That's right, and it's so easy to do, right, to get caught up in the little details. That's why we have to be grounded in daily prayer, that we have that, because that's what keeps our anchor, that's what keeps our first love burning.
Right, you know? Exactly. We head out to Panama, where Father Mark is there with Jason Everett. Maybe give us some sense of your feelings of listening to the Holy Father's you know, words in his homily?
Yes, thanks, Doug. We're out at St. John Paul II Field, where the vigil's going to be tonight and the closing mass tomorrow. And they've already kicked up the music, so we have music behind us.
A little beat.
But I was very moved by that consecration of the altar. I thought the mass, the ritual was done with such solemnity and simplicity, yeah. and the beauty of that cathedral. I thought that was very moving. Just everything seemed so appropriate yeah. and fitting.
Yeah, I don't think enough people get to see that, of just how the altar is set apart. It's dedicated, you know, as the commentator had mentioned. It's not for to be put thing. You're not supposed to put things on the altar. It's not right. somewhere to put your bottle of water or whatever. I mean, right. it is set apart for sacred use, and I just wish more people had the blessing of experiencing a liturgy like that.
Yeah, and as Father Patrick, I think, mentioned, we saw that ritual at the shrine in Hansville. Mother Angelica built the shrine up there, and Bishop Foley, by barehandedly, you know, spread that chrism.
Yeah.
Just a beautiful, powerful image. And I know you've talked about the analogy to baptism. And the commentator mentioned it too, the Vatican commentator.
Yeah, the altar almost goes through everything that we go through as a Christian. I mean, it's given the holy water like we are at baptism. It's anointed with the oil of chrism like we are at baptism. And then it's closed with a garment like we're given after baptism. And the candles are placed upon it like we receive candles to be a light to the world. And so it's that image of Christ in the church, you know, and ultimately in us. And if we just knew how rich the symbolism was behind every aspect of the liturgy, I think it would make it that much easier to enter into prayer.
And I am kicking myself. I actually missed the moment when the Pope placed the gilded rose in Our Lady's statue, her hands. And I wanted to see that, but they tell me he went up the steps and did that beautiful gesture, I think, of entrusting ourselves to Our Lady, especially under this title, Patroness of Panama, and I think of, you could say, over all the Americas with the Spanish influence. Spanish missionaries just went everywhere. So I think we all need to pray to her, ask for her intercession. Two, you know, I think that's part of the solution. I know, I think it touched all of us when we talked about these temptations we have of a weariness of hope, you know, a subtle weariness that, you know, does the gospel, does it really apply to the world today?
Yeah.
We can lose confidence in that because of maybe sin in the church or whatever. Are discouraging results.
And the Holy Father kind of contrasted two kinds of weariness. You know, one, the weariness of just working in the vineyard where you get worn down and tired, which is natural, and Christ experienced that. I remember St. John Bosco saying once, first tell the devil to rest, and then I'll rest too. And so we all want to have that perseverance, but sometimes the sun beats you down. And the Holy Father said that, you know, that's natural and normal. But then he contrasts that with a different type of weariness. When he explains, it's the weariness of hope, a particular type tiredness of heart that calls into question the energy, resources, and viability of our mission in this changing and challenging world. He says it's one of the worst heresies possible in our time, this notion that the Lord and our communities really have nothing to say or contribute to the new world now being born. So this despondency, this lethargy of just like, hey, everything's going to hell in a handbasket, what can we have to do to offer? Right. And he says that's one of the greatest heresies of our modern time.
And I, you know, as our Holy Father mentions a lot, you know, I think he's very eloquent on the temptations in ministry and this kind of weariness. And as our world just seems to be speeding up and getting busier and busier, everyone's personally busy, we're all distracted, we need the gospel message more than ever, guide the ship, because it is hurtling somewhere. We got to be sure that the gospel is there to guide it and to inspire the right solutions. You know, I was struck too by, you know, he says we all need to find a well to be refreshed, you know, Doug and Father Patrick mentioned, you know, some of the solutions he gives. You know, we need to ask for that drink. We need to go to the Lord and return to the well of our first love.
Yeah.
That's the one that always gets me. You know, we start things and we have such zeal and we have such generosity. And I think the youth teach us that. You know, they're reminded of that generous, I'm available.
Yeah.
You know, youth don't have a lot in terms of wealth or worldly possessions, so they're free.
Yeah.
And we all need to be in that state of freedom.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter where we're at in life that we can dip into that. I mean, because you often hear commentators explain that the woman was at the well during the noontime hour, and typically that's not when women would draw water from a well. You'd go, you know, not in the heat of the day, but early in the morning. And so the fact that she was going in the middle of the day is an indication she's probably an outcast from society, and you learn about her history and you see why. But even when we feel furthest from God, that well is available to us, that Christ is meeting us there. And I think one of my favorite lines that the Holy Father said is that the Spirit inspired no specific works, pastoral plans, or structures during these difficult times, but instead, through any number of saints next door, he gave life and fresh breath to a particular moment of history when all hope and dignity seemed to be stifled and crushed. So the Holy Spirit's answer to the problems in the world today is not more programs, it's more saints. Like, what we have right now is a crisis of holiness more than anything.
Yeah, he talked about that where faith is like being crushed, you know, where it's disintegrating, you know, as part of that challenge. You know, it's like the world on the outside seems to be doing well, maybe creating wealth or whatever, but interiorly we're losing faith. Mm-hmm. And so we need to find that well. And he talks about returning to the founding charism, as Father Patrick mentioned, you know, not just for religious orders, but the church herself, the life of the church. What's her mission? You know, she is a mission that she is sent into the world. You know, that invigorates us. If we participate in spreading the faith, you know, our faith is renewed. And as you said, you know, to look at others around us. And again, you know, I think that's one of the gifts of World Youth Day, especially for the young person involved. There's the exchange of culture that happens. You know, people can share their faith, you know, the experiences they've had, the country they're in. We saw that the way of the cross, you know, different countries, different sufferings. And they can tell the story of their experience of faith and how it helped them fight their challenges.
Yeah, I'm especially excited for the American pilgrims coming down, because I think sometimes there's a poverty that comes with affluence. And then when you get to other countries that may not be as well off financially, you know, Panama's not a developing country in the strict sense. There's a lot of affluence here in some areas. But for the young people of America to come to see the simplicity of the faith, that's so rich here. Because typically the countries that I visit that are poorest economically are often millionaires when it comes to the faith.
Right.
Because they know that their hope is not in this earth. Their hope is not they're going to win Powerball and be billionaires. Their hope is in heaven. And that permeates their entire life with that wisdom and the simplicity that comes from that pure faith.
And, you know, I wonder too, like, those of us in the, you know, the more affluent countries have experienced a culture of death, the sexual revolution.
Yep.
As we mentioned, you know, the lay movements were in the cathedral today as well to hear this message, that they bring a solution from out of their experience of being hurt by the culture that, you know, can help others too. That I think I think that is something a gift, especially Americans, can bring.
Yeah, because I think the church is hurt universally, you know, but I think God is doing a wonderful thing right now in the church that maybe needed to happen 70, 80 years ago, and it's going to be a painful purification. I think it's almost like pouring hydrogen peroxide on a wound. I mean, it's going to fizz, it's going to be ugly, but when it's all said and done, it's going to be purer and stronger and healthier. And so I think that the Holy Spirit is doing this globally. Although it may be painful, it's a purification that's going to make the church stronger.
And you know, a point I loved is what the Archbishop said, Archbishop Jose Domingo Ulloa Mendiata. He said, you know, Panama has received the faith from the hands of Our Lady. Mm-hmm. And there's a special Marian presence, you know, and you know, you can see that in the South American, the Latin cultures, you know, Guadalupe, and but just everywhere. There's all these particular devotions to Our Lady. So she just seems to have a special love for this people.
Yeah, you see the apparitions of Our Lady. She typically is always appearing to those who are simple of heart and of mind. She's not appearing to people who have doctorates in theology, because we would mess up the message. So she goes to those who are simple of heart, because she can pour her message through them in an undiluted way.
So for me, I think that theme of from the Annunciation, let it be done to me according to thy word, is such a powerful theme for us as members of the church to rediscover that charism of discipleship, of mission, to be a disciple as Mary was, to have that faith and that courage to step out for the Lord. So we'll throw back to you, Doug, from St. John Paul II Field out here in Panama City.
Very good. Thank you so much, Father Mark and Jason Everett, for those insights following up to the morning mass where we just ended with the Holy Father. And, of course, I'm here with Father Patrick. And that kind of wraps things up for us this morning. And, of course, the Holy Father now, he's right now still meeting with the various people exiting the cathedral there. And he'll be heading out to the San Jose Major Seminary. He'll be actually having lunch with some youth who've been invited to spend some time with him. But we will be back, actually, at 5:45 p.m. Eastern. That's because, obviously, that event with the youth is not being televised, at least not by us. And we'll bring you the very important vigil with young people from the Metro Field, which is Metro Park, which has been renamed in honor of St. John Paul II Field for this particular event. And, of course, Pope Francis will be central to that vigil as we roll into tonight, then into tomorrow morning with the big send-off mass, which we'll be covering as well. So for Father Patrick and myself, we invite you to stay with us. Join us back at 5:45 p.m. Eastern here on EWTN, complete coverage of World Youth Day.